Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Essential Oils and Aromatherapy for Dummies, Second Edition, by Kathi Keville, narrated by Courtney Patterson. Publisher's note: in this audio edition, you will hear references to figures and tables present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Limit of liability / disclaimer of warranty. While the publisher and authors have used their best efforts in preparing this work, they make no representations or warranties with respect to the accuracy or completeness of the contents of this work, and specifically disclaim all warranties, including, without limitation, any implied warranties of merchantability or fitness for a particular purpose. No warranty may be created or extended by sales representatives, written sales materials, or promotional statements for this work. The fact that an organization, website, or product is referred to in this work as a citation and/or potential source of further information does not mean that the publisher and authors endorse the information or services the organization, website, or product may provide or recommendations it may make. This work is sold with the understanding that the publisher is not engaged in rendering professional services. The advice and strategies contained herein may not be suitable for your situation. You should consult with a specialist where appropriate. Further, readers should be aware that websites listed in this work may have changed or disappeared between when this work was written and when it is read. Neither the publisher nor author shall be liable for any loss of profit or any other commercial damages, including but not limited to special, incidental, consequential, or other damages. Introduction. If you're like most people, you take the smell of a flower or the scent of freshly baked bread for granted. That's because fragrance is all around, every day and everywhere. Scent may be commonplace, but you'll have to agree that it greatly enhances life. And it does more than provide enjoyment. As its name implies, aromatherapy is indeed a therapy that uses essential oils for healing. Essential oils offer a way for you to literally smell your way to good health. You can't beat a prescription that reads, "Bathe with scented oils twice a week." Essential Oils and Aromatherapy for Dummies is your guide to a new way to stay healthy and fit, and to take care of yourself when you do get sick. Aromatherapy works on many levels. It can treat emotional as well as physical problems, and even help you think better or improve your athletic performance. Sensual essential oils can improve your love and your sex life. No wonder such a large selection of scented products is now available. Everything from candles to facial cream to room freshener is promising to bring essential oils into your life. About this book. Essential oils and aromatherapy cover a lot of territory, so I've written this book to guide you through the clouds of wafting aromas. I'll show you how to make real sense out of this topic. I've been enjoying the benefits of essential oils for decades and sharing them with others almost that long. Simply put, I'm impressed. I think you will be too. In this book, you discover the world of fragrance along with dozens of ways that aromatherapy can enhance your health and general well-being. Essential Oils and Aromatherapy for Dummies helps you understand essential oils so that you can savor and enjoy the pleasures and benefits. It's also a guide to using essential oils effectively and safely. I show you how to bring essential oils into your home, your work, and wherever you go. One of the best things about aromatherapy is the ease and enjoyment that comes with it. Using essential oils is so simple. I include more than 100 recipes that I developed so that you can whip up a scent for everything from oily skin to indigestion. Most of these recipes take less than 5 minutes to make. Really? This book contains so many features you won't find covered in other books on the subject. For starters, you are given an amazing selection of essential oil formulas to treat dozens of physical and emotional conditions in the symptom guide. Not only does the guide describe how you can use them, but it gives you tips on additional treatments to enhance your healing. The detailed descriptions of essential oils in the Essential Oil Guide explain how to use each one. What really makes this book stand out are the guidelines that you'll need for using essential oils effectively and safely. You learn not only about which essential oils you need to use extra carefully or avoid, but also help in making good choices. And while you're making those choices, here's a book that guides you through the confusion of the botanical names and the many variations and types of each oil. It takes the surprise out of essential oils by explaining how oils can change, for good and bad, with age and different storage conditions. All of this knowledge is available to you through the easy access organization of this book, which includes lists to help you learn exactly what you need to know. Additional information adds a little noteworthy color to what you're reading. Foolish assumptions. Probably I do know you at least a little. You're already intrigued by aroma, so you can't help wondering what all the fuss is about essential oils. Maybe you're missing out on something that could really be a plus in your life and help a few physical, and maybe even some emotional, issues that you're working on. You want to spice up your life with fragrance. You want to know if aroma is really a therapy, and if so, how it works. You're interested in the feel-good results provided by using essential oils. Icons verbalized in this book. Tip marks tips and shortcuts that you can use to make using essential oils and aromatherapy even easier. A lot of these are the tips that I've discovered by trial and error, so I save you the expense of learning the hard way. It just pays to remember some things. When you hear this icon, I'm telling you something that you'll probably want to know about essential oils in the future. This way, you can pay special attention when you hear this information. The technical stuff icon marks information of a highly technical nature that you can normally skip over. It might be intriguing information to have, but it's not essential. Essential oils are very concentrated and need to be used with respect. Throughout this book, you find an occasional warning to make sure you play it safe. Beyond this book. In addition to the abundance of information and guidance related to essential oils and aromatherapy that I provide in this book, you get access to even more help and information online at dummies.com. Check out this book's online cheat sheet. Just go to dummies.com and search for Essential Oils and Aromatherapy for Dummies cheat sheet. Where to go from here? Chances are that you've already experienced aromatherapy, even if you haven't used essential oils. If you've ever sipped a cup of chamomile tea, rubbed on rose or lavender-scented hand lotion, or sniffed a cinnamon roll, you've already enjoyed aromatherapy. Where you go from here is into an adventure that combines enticing fragrances with good health. You have a guide that can gently lead you to explore the many facets of this therapy. Is some ailment bugging you? Then head straight to Chapter 2 to understand how essential oils work, and then look up your specific problem in the symptom guide. Maybe you're feeling great physically, but you're too tired or need to have a little more focus? Then head to Chapter 9 to help you stay alert. Want some hints on how to use essential oils? Then go through Chapter 6. Wherever you turn in this book, you'll find plenty of information that will hopefully spark ideas that will further your involvement with essential oils. 1. Getting started with essential oils. In this part, understand essential oils and what they do. Educate your nose to smell differences in scents. Be a savvy aromatherapy and essential oil shopper. Use essential oils safely. Create your own essential oil products. Chapter 1. Making sense out of scents. In this chapter, understanding the wonder behind the words essential oils of aromatherapy. viewing essential oil medicines, using and applying essential oils, seeing the potential benefits of essential oils, playing botanist to sort through oils. How many times have you leaned into a bouquet of flowers to inhale their fragrance? Perhaps you've taken a deep breath of pine or fir while walking in a park or forest, or brought a fresh Christmas tree into your home. Stroll through a flower or herb garden, and the scents that waft around you with each step engage your imagination. Maybe you've sat down to a cup of peppermint tea and enjoyed the aroma as much as drinking the tea. With so many different smells surrounding you, you probably don't give them a second thought. Or at least you may not yet. In this chapter, I begin to explain how all this sensation from a bouquet of flowers, a pine forest, or your cup of tea is due to essential oils. This chapter gives you just a sniff of essential oil basics and the study and practice of aromatherapy. The rest of the book digs deeper into various subtopics. Defining essential oils. Essential oils are derived from medicinal plants that are commonly referred to as herbs. You may have gone in search of some herbal remedies to take care of a headache, or reached for cough syrup or throat lozenges that contains medicinal herbs. Herbs that are aromatic contain essential oils that produce a plant's scent. Not all plants contain essential oils, but the ones that do hold them in special glands. It's easy for you to identify the plants with these oils. Simply smell the plant. If there's a scent, it contains essential oils. Roses, violets, rosemary bushes, and even Christmas trees all owe their distinctive aromas to essential oils. Technical stuff. Essential oils can be extracted from a plant using several methods. Once extracted, a pure essential oil is slightly oily to the touch. Although technically an oil, it is much thinner than vegetable oils used in cooking, such as canola or olive. Essential oils are composed of such tiny compounds that the oils feel thin and seem to disappear when you rub them between your fingers. They also don't leave an oily stain on cloth and evaporate easily into the air. Because they dissipate so quickly, another name for essential oils is volatile oils. That's a good description of them because volatile means vaporous, or to be like gas. See Chapter 15 for more on the science behind the oils. The scent glands in a plant that produce essential oils can occur anywhere, but they are most likely found in the flowers and leaves. Not all plants need essential oils to survive, yet those that do have them put them to good use. For a long time, botanists couldn't figure out why plants went to the trouble of producing these oils. Now they know that essential oils play important roles for plants. They attract bees and other pollinators. They repel harmful insects. Some repel other plants so that they don't crowd the space. They kill bacterial, viral, and fungal infections. They seal and heal the plant's wounds. They help make the plant waterproof. They increase the plant's immunity to disease. Acting like plant hormones, some influence plant reproduction. Following your nose. Nowadays, they're sold everywhere, but it's relatively new that you can purchase essential oils. Although they have been distilled for hundreds of years, and quite possibly long before that, they were obtained from aromatic plants only by early chemists, the alchemists. These rare essential oils found their way into a few exclusive cosmetics, but were not generally available. Even a few decades ago, when I started working as an aromatherapist, almost no essential oils were available. I could only find peppermint and birch, sold as wintergreen essential oils, and that was only in drugstores. I had to search out large essential oil companies distributing to the food and perfume industries for my first set of essential oils. Times have certainly changed. What's so essential about these oils? Aromatic compounds that were first distilled from plants were coined essential by poetic alchemists of long ago. They believed that a plant's fragrance represents its inner nature or essence. Fragrance is invisible, so it was easy to consider it etheric and akin to a person's soul. It was commonly used to inspire prayer and meditation. Indeed, one of the earliest uses of fragrant plants was as incense for religious ceremonies, an application still popular throughout the world where it has moved into Hindu and Buddhist temples, Japanese Taoist and Shinto practices, Catholic churches, and indigenous American and African healing ceremonies. Defining aromatherapy. Aromatherapy is the technique of using essential oils, which are always aromatic, for healing therapy. The beauty of essential oils is that they are an aroma-based therapy. All those good scents make working with essential oils and using them a wonderful experience. After all, if essential oils have an emphasis, it's that they make you feel great just sniffing them. What I love about aromatherapy is how it is truly holistic. Aims to treat the whole person. It embraces the body, mind, spirit concept by working on all these levels. That means the essential oils used in an aromatherapy practice address healing on several levels, as they have done in traditional medicine around the world. No matter where your ancestry lies, your people certainly used aromatic plants for healing. In fact, the use of aromatic plants is thought to be one of the oldest forms of healing. A tradition-based practice, it works in our modern world as well as it did ages ago. Technical stuff. As an herbalist and aromatherapist, I always view aromatherapy as a part of herbalism. If you look at the most important types of healing compounds and herbs, essential oils are right at the top because essential oils are responsible for many herbs' healing attributes. Although most of Western medicine typically relies on medical procedures and pharmaceuticals, modern science has also turned its attention to the healing capabilities of essential oils. When researchers looked for possible candidates to study, they first investigated the uses of aromatic plants that have been recorded in herbal manuscripts and embedded into worldwide folklore. What they discovered is that the old manuscripts were right. Yes, chamomile really does reduce pain. Lavender can help you sleep. Rosemary helps you think better. Some essential oils reduce bruising and inflammation. From these first aromatic findings, research moved on to explore a potpourri of aromatic experiences and provided a scientific foundation for essential oil use. Aromatherapy is often used in conjunction with other forms of therapy to heal various ailments. This is because it's a perfect, non-intrusive way to balance emotions. For example, incense can be burned during a yoga class. Someone experiencing an anxiety attack can simply spray an essential oil into the air, and a beneficial effect wafts through the room. As an adjunct therapy, aromatherapy can promote relaxation or focus and relieve anxiety and nervousness. I often refer to it as a feel-good therapy to improve almost any situation. Check out Chapter 6 for many ways to create a mood room with scent. In addition to affecting mood, aromatherapy can help to heal a long list of physical problems. Aromatherapy is especially useful when you're dealing with conditions that you normally treat yourself anyway, such as a headache, muscle spasm, or insomnia. Instead of heading to the drugstore, you'll be reaching for rose geranium or peppermint essential oil. To use aromatherapy wisely, read Chapter 4. There's no denying that certain fragrances from essential oils put your mind into a relaxed focus that promotes prayer and meditation. How aromatherapy addresses the soul is fascinating and a little mysterious. Science hasn't backed this use yet. I like how the essential oils that traditionally have been used in religious settings to inspire devotion are now non-denominational. The scent of essential oils like frankincense, myrrh, sandalwood, and juniper work for everyone. While you may be using frankincense to relax a muscle, its scent floating in the air touches a spiritual aspect, which can help you create or tap into a core of strength to deal with whatever physical and emotional conditions come your way. Aromatherapy is becoming a household word, and you'll find a large assortment of essential oils readily available online and in brick-and-mortar stores. See chapters in this book that cover more information on individual topics. Refer to Chapter 8 for tips on using aromatherapy to create romance. Chapter 6 explains how to scent your living and workspace. The guides at the end of this book help you find the right oils and scents for your needs. Using oils for healing. Essential oils have a lot in common when it comes to medicine. Due to their general makeup, most essential oils are highly antiseptic and able to kill an assortment of harmful bacterial and viral infections. Many also reduce inflammation to help eliminate pain, which can result when an inflamed or infected area presses on your nerves. Quite a few of these oils also encourage wounds to heal more quickly because they stimulate the repair of cells. All these actions combine into an excellent treatment for your minor injuries, such as cuts, tight or cramped muscles, arthritis, headaches, and inflammation. Over and over, I've seen essential oils quickly knock out an infection, relieve a bruise, or ease a cramping muscle. Here's a list of essential oils' most important medicinal properties. Kill bacterial, viral, and fungal infections. Heal wounds. Reduce inflammation. Regulate hormones. Tone skin. Stimulate the immune system. Influence reproductive hormones. Improve blood circulation and warm the skin. Improve digestion. Decrease sinus and lung congestion. Remember, not all essential oils are pros at everything on this list. Some perform better than others, doing one thing or another. This book will show you which essential oils do what. Refer to the Essential Oil Guide and the Symptom Guide for help. Getting aromas into the body. There are two main ways to use essential oils. One is by inhaling their aroma through your nose. The other is to dilute them so you can rub them on your skin. Of course, when you rub them on your skin, you also get the benefit of being able to inhale the scent at the same time. Under your skin. Essential oil molecules are amazingly small. Their tiny size gives them some of their superpowers. An example is their ability to get under your skin when you rub them on. Your skin is very protective about what it lets through. You don't want just anything entering your body, and your skin knows that. So it has a tight structure and protective coating to keep out harmful things like dirt and grime and whatever you touch. After all, anything that's able to penetrate skin reaches blood vessels, moves into the bloodstream, and is then circulated throughout the body to reach all of your cells. It's because they are so small that almost all essential oils are absorbed quickly when applied to the skin and are able to pass through your skin. Some of the oil is absorbed into skin layers. Some reach even farther, into underlying tissue. A small amount moves into the bloodstream. On the other hand, some remains on the surface of your skin and evaporates into the air as fragrance. This absorption doesn't happen all at once. Essential oils are made up of many different compounds, and some pass more quickly through your skin than others. The tiniest, most absorbable components in lavender and clove oils appear in the blood only 20 minutes after being rubbed on the skin. You can detect bergamot, anise, and lemon on the breath 40 to 60 minutes after rubbing them on the skin. Even larger compounds take just a little longer. Chemists say three things determine how quickly a compound goes through skin: its size, shape, and function. Because some essential oil compounds are tinier than others, it's the small ones with simple shapes that move through the quickest. Function refers to conditions such as water solubility. Heat also speeds things up. Warm skin, warm body oil, massage techniques like using hot rocks or compresses, and even a hot day all increase this essential oil migration. Absorption rates are also influenced by your skin type. For example, essential oils penetrate dry, flaky, broken, or freshly washed skin more easily. Any aromatherapy product that contains vegetable oil, and that includes skin lotion, facial cream, salve, and massage oil, slows the absorption of essential oils into your skin. What's happening is that large molecules in vegetable oils, such as almond and olive oil, are simply too big to go into your skin, so they slide over the top of your skin. While they're doing all that sliding around, they hold on to some of the essential oil. Eventually, most of these suspended essential oil compounds find their way into the skin. This spreads out the essential oil's good effects over time, much like a time-release factor. Tip: test this one out at home. Cut a clove of garlic in half and rub the cut side liberally on the bottom of your foot. Put socks on and wait for the results of the experiment. It takes your blood system about 20 minutes to carry the essential oil of garlic throughout your bloodstream. You'll know because you'll be able to taste it. Not only can you taste garlic, but its powerful antiseptic action is going to work throughout your body. You may not want to do this experiment before attending a social event. Technical stuff. Essential oils are derived from aromatic plants, many of which are medicinal herbs that are used for healing. That means the essential oil carries at least some healing properties of the herb from which it was derived. Sometimes, clinical herbalists and aromatherapists turn to the herb and sometimes the oil for a remedy. The decision of which one to use depends on the condition that's being treated and what medicinal properties are needed. Because aromatic herbs contain the essential oil, there are times when either the herb or oil will do the trick. Take the herb rosemary, for example. If you want something to relieve sore muscles, you can use a concoction that has the herb rosemary extracted into a base like olive oil, or one that has rosemary essential oils added to it. Essential oils have some advantages over non-aromatic herbs. They're fast to reach their destination. Say that you have a sore muscle. Rub on a massage or body oil that contains the anti-inflammatory essential oil of lavender or chamomile over a sore area, and you'll send the medicine quickly into the underlying area, your tight muscle. Compare that to using non-aromatic herbs. Drinking an herb tea or downing a pill or extract are all good medicine. However, while herbs do a great job of treating skin disorders and complexion problems on the skin surface, they rarely go more than skin deep. When applied topically, most herbal compounds lay on the skin surface. The medicine doesn't reach deep into tissue under the skin to help heal it. This limits herbs to topical use. Our skin is a great protective barrier. Otherwise, everything we touch could enter our bodies. The advantages of having those tiny essential oils pass through your skin via topical application include the following. Right on target. Essential oils can be applied right on or over the specific area that needs treatment. Go deep. Essential oils penetrate deep into underlying tissue to work their healing magic. Have a happy liver. Not only does the problem area get most of the medicinal dose, but less essential oil ends up circulating in your bloodstream. The result is less essential oil has to be processed by your liver. That translates into less work for your liver and a lower chance of too much essential oil producing a toxic reaction in your body. Using the lizard brain. After the nose gathers information about aroma, it sends a report to your brain. That information bypasses the central nervous system and the areas of the brain that control reasoning. Instead, the nose sends its fragrance facts to a very old part of your brain called the limbic system for processing. The primitive limbic system is sometimes called the lizard brain because it works in a similar fashion to the simple brain of a reptile to plug into your basic survival instincts. If you want to understand the limbic system better, think about what a lizard needs. To find food and a mate, be alerted to danger, remember a few survival skills, recognize its territory, and maintain its body's healthy equilibrium. All these requirements are associated with a sense of smell. Because it is the limbic system's job to alert your body's warning system of potential danger, it signals the fight or flight response. This causes your adrenals to provide a rush of adrenaline with its resulting burst of energy during an emergency. The higher parts of your brain that control long-term memory also receive information about fragrances. The limbic system, and thus our sense of smell, directly communicates with the brain's hypothalamus and pituitary. Both are considered master glands because they regulate so many body functions. Through these glands, your sense of smell helps direct various hormone and immune system activity and what regulates appetite, digestion, sexual arousal, memory, body temperature, and heartbeat. Anthropologists and psychologists are exploring why your sense of smell is closely linked to these areas. They assume that at one time, smell played an important role in survival. Perhaps 5 times more powerful in your ancestors than it is today, this super sense enabled them to smell spoiled food, the potency of their plant medicines, their kin, recognize friend or foe, and be attracted to a mate. This keen sense of smell also helped treat illnesses. It is likely that the use of aroma as therapy goes back to the earliest uses of plants as medicine. The first recorded uses of aromatherapy are from Egypt, Mesopotamia, and China, just after 3000 BC. From Rose to Nose. Certain scents make you think better and faster, while others work on your emotions. Some mood-lifting aromas are antidepressants, some are relaxants, and still others act as stimulants. To learn which oil does what to improve your moods, refer to Chapter 9 and the Essential Oil Guide. The molecules that produce aromas are too small to see with your eye, yet the air is filled with these microscopic particles of scent. Simply brushing against a fragrant plant or opening a vial of essential oil releases thousands of aromatic molecules into the air, where they freely float to your nose, which is happening in Figure 1-1, included in the print and ebook formats of this book. Every time you sniff something aromatic, say your favorite fragrant flower or perfume, thousands of tiny scent molecules tumble into your nose. High up in your nose, smell receptors await these compounds. They send information about what you smell to your olfactory bulb. Olfactory is scientific lingo for smell. These receptors are able to tell the difference between all of the many odor molecules because, much like your fingerprints, each aromatic molecule is unique. One way they differentiate the compounds is according to their shape. Think of essential oil compounds like a child's building blocks that come in all sorts of shapes and sizes. Your brain recognizes the difference. It collects the information and sends it a charge or code to your sense of smell. The higher brain collects the information to relay it to wherever it is needed and alter your body physically or emotionally. All of this happens very rapidly and is why you can smell the difference between a lemon and a lime. It's also why the scent of chamomile makes you dreamy, while eucalyptus is a wake-up call. Capturing the benefits of essential oils. Essential oils can really work some magic on the mind and body. I know this from my clinical and personal experiences, but it's also been proven by various studies. The Fragrance Research Fund has collaborated with the Psychophysiology Department at Yale University to discover how the aromas of essential oils affect behavior. In one of their programs, they followed more than 2,000 people for 20 years. They found that simply inhaling fragrance helps with a long list of complaints, including fatigue, pain, insomnia, depression, nervousness, migraines, and memory loss. Research even points to an aromatherapy treating schizophrenia and sexual dysfunction. Many health providers are turning to aromatherapy to supplement treatment plans. They like its quick action and how it so easily helps with emotions. The Mayo Clinic has trained more than 2,000 physicians and nurses so far in using essential oils. They're putting the aroma from essential oils in the air before dispensing medication to patients. For example, Fairview Clinics in Minnesota use ginger and spearmint to alleviate nausea and lemon and mandarin to ease anxiety and insomnia. The Mayo Clinic also sells inhalation sticks containing essential oils for patients to use at home. Stimulants, such as peppermint and eucalyptus, intensify brain waves to sharpen the mind and quicken your reaction. This action is very similar to what happens if you drink coffee, but without caffeine's detrimental impact on your adrenal glands. A calming scent like chamomile has the opposite effect. It slows brainwave patterns to produce relaxation, similar to taking a sedative drug, but without side effects. Pleasant smells put people into better moods and make them more willing to cooperate and compromise. Psychologists have had a field day testing this out. Dr. Susan Schiffman, professor of medical psychology at North Carolina's Duke University, put how scent affects people's minds to the test. She got on the New York City subway and sprayed food scents into the cars. Under the influence of scent, passengers pushed and shoved each other 40% less, and they made fewer nasty comments. At Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center in New York City and at hospitals across the United States, scents of lavender, chamomile, and vanilla have relaxed patients undergoing invasive procedures or MRI, magnetic resonance imaging, scanning. Other successful treatments are just a sniff away. Researchers are hoping to uncover all the ways in which essential oils heal. They at least want aromatherapy to improve the quality of life for people who suffer from several disorders. Essential oils may offer the ability to take fewer pharmaceutical drugs when the two are used together. Warning: don't try to reduce your prescription drugs without your doctor's approval. You could end up harming your health more than improving it. Remember, the effect of fragrances on your mind and emotions may be subtle, but the smell alone makes you feel better about yourself. It can improve your mood, reduce stress, cause you to become more energetic, or help you relax or fall asleep more easily. The bottom line is that you are happier. In this way, it achieves the goals set by self-help books and seminars. After all, feeling good about yourself makes you less combative, jealous, and angry. You also feel more in control of your life, and that makes you less frustrated and more satisfied with life. Not bad results for a little sniff of a pleasant fragrance. A rose by any other name. The essential oils that are used therapeutically have the same names as the plants from which they're derived. These are called common names and what I use throughout this book. These are the names you already know, such as rose, lavender, and lemon. This keeps it simple and makes it easy reading for you. However, plants and their essential oils also have scientific names that are in Latin or Greek. Botanists group plants according to how they look. The more similar the physical characteristics, the closer the relationship. Remember, whether you're new to essential oils or already a pro, understanding scientific plant names is very important to you. You won't be able to negotiate through the maze of essential oils for sale without a basic understanding of botany. These names are the only way you can make sure that you're buying the correct essential oils, because some plants and the essential oils derived from them share the same common name. Why all this fuss about Latin words and classifications? For one thing, go with common names alone, and you will be in for a surprise. Quite a few plants share the same common names, but they don't necessarily share the same medicinal properties or scent. A few examples of common names you may encounter that describe more than one oil are basil, cedarwood, chamomile, fir, and jasmine. There's tea tree from Australia, but there's also a New Zealand tea tree or manuka. While both trees are in the same botanical family, the myrtle family, they are distinctly different. The same thing occurs with chamomile. The essential oil could be German chamomile or perhaps Roman chamomile, or maybe it's gold or cape chamomile. German chamomile is far more anti-inflammatory than the less popular Roman chamomile, so more valuable to use on a condition like inflamed skin. I sniff either one for a relaxing effect. To toss in even more confusion, if you buy bergamot or spikenard essential oils, it won't be the common garden bergamot or the herb called spikenard. There are also many variations of lavender and rosemary. To help you sort all of this out, these differences are further explained in the essential oil guide. breaking down the system. The organizational system that essential oils fall into is officially called plant taxonomy. The full scientific names of plants come from a combination of different information. Some are named after the botanists who identified them, in honor of a person or place, or according to what a plant looks like. When you go to purchase an essential oil, you'll first see the plant's common name. It is followed by the scientific botanical name, which is written in italics to distinguish it as a non-English name. Some aromatherapy products pass on giving you the common name and only list the botanical names of the essential oils on their ingredient list. Each botanical name has two parts. The first part of the name is called the genus. A lot of related plants are included in this. The genus is followed by the species, which designates a specific plant. Together, these are called the binomials, or two names. Here's another way to look at botanical names. Say your name is Ann Smith. In botany, that would be written Smith Ann. This designates the Smiths as being related and thus having similarities. It also shows that there's just one of you. You can see how this essential oil naming works if you look at two aromatic plants in the same genus. Let's take citrus. Among the members of this genus are lemon, Citrus limonum, and bergamot, Citrus bergamia. They are in the same citrus genus. You can tell just by their botanical names that they're related. The fact that they have different species names shows they aren't the same plant. Because they're in the same genus, it is likely that they do share some medicinal properties and may have a similar scent. And they do. Technical stuff. When chemists get involved in this naming game, they sometimes add yet another category that's called a chemotype. You'll also encounter them when purchasing essential oils. Chemotypes are subspecies of plants. They look alike but have different chemical components in their essential oils. This usually occurs when the same plant grows in different locations. This means its aroma and use are also slightly different. See Chapter 15 for more on chemotypes and their differences and uses. Specifying species. Most essential oils that you'll see for sale come from the most common species of herb used medicinally. These aromatic herbs are the ones that are grown for production or, in some cases, harvested from the wild. There's often more species in the genus that aren't being distilled commercially to be turned into essential oils because there's not enough demand for them. Species that are in the same genus have similar botanical characteristics and usually have related DNA. The closer species are related, the better the chance that they have a similar chemistry and use, as well as aroma. Even so, they are rarely exactly alike. Even slight chemical alterations can make a difference in how you use the essential oils. The downside is it can be confusing to sort out which oil you need. The upside is that this offers an opportunity to explore new essential oils and fine-tune the aromatherapy formulas you create. Following are the essential oils that are available in several different species or varieties. Sometimes their effects on the brain and mind are similar, sometimes not. Chamomile essential oil is produced from several different plants that are not even in the same genus. Some uses are similar, yet not necessarily interchangeable. The most popular oil is German chamomile, which reduces inflammation and muscle pain better than Roman chamomile. Other oils include Cape chamomile, which is another good anti-inflammatory and muscle relaxant, somewhat similar to German chamomile. There is also a gold chamomile that is more akin to Roman chamomile. Cinnamon essential oil can be from the less expensive species cassia or true but much hotter cinnamon. Eucalyptus essential oil has so many species that are distilled. Lemon eucalyptus contains so much of the compound called citronellol that it is a great bug repellent with a delightful lemony scent. Radiata is specific to treat sinus and herpes infections, while Australiana takes care of lung congestion and sore throat. Smithy is a gentle version, so it's used for children and sensitive individuals. These are the most common species of eucalyptus that are sold today. Fir essential oil comes as balsam fir, Canadian fir, and Siberian fir, which tend to be used interchangeably, although a good nose can detect their slightly different scent. Lavender essential oil is most often the standard English lavender or one of its many lavandin hybrids, such as those named Provence and Grosso. There's also spike, French, Spanish, and various specialty lavenders from different regions. Spike lavender is especially good for treating sinus and lung congestion and acne. The camphorous-smelling Spanish lavender, Lavendula stocus, is a strong wound healer that helps to ease sore muscles. Sage essential oil is the common cooking sage. Spanish sage and a few other sages are also produced, which have a distinctive lavender fragrance and are less irritating to skin. Both are strong antiseptics. Clary sage is a species that is designated as clary, which is less antiseptic, but its scent produces more of a heavy, relaxing effect than common sage. Tea tree essential oil is derived from a few similar species, such as MQV, Melaleuca quincunerva. MQV is considered the most antiviral species. It has sweeter, more pleasant scent, so it is easier to mix with other essential oils into a nice-smelling blend. The harsher kajaput is another species, but one that is rarely used. Dealing with name changes. The classifications of plants in modern botany are being influenced and changed according to DNA reports on the plants themselves. This is changing the world of botany from being solely based on physical appearances to paying attention to genetics. Some plants are being moved from one category to another based solely on their DNA. As a result, numerous botanical names have changed because a plant is no longer in the same genus. These changes are creating a more accurate system of plant relatives, but also causing some confusion. Warning. When you read older aromatherapy references, you're bound to encounter some outdated names. Make sure you double-check the names you find in older books with updated information you can find online. One well-known herb that has had a name change in recent years is rosemary. It has now joined the salvia genus that already encompasses sage and lavender. Its new botanical name is Salvia rosmarinus, leaving behind the previous Rosmarinus officinalis. Technical stuff. Botanists are always refining plants' genealogy themselves. Their changes are often based on microscopic differences in plant structure. They have changed vetiver's botanical name from Vetivera zizanoides to the new Chrysopogon zizanoides. This happened after years of speculation that the entire genus called Vetiveria should really be merged into Chrysopogon. Chapter 2. Sniffing the Diff. What to Look For in a Scent. In this chapter, training your nose and using it to choose scents you love. Breaking down the scents by type, quality, and notes. Blending oils to make great scents. When you get down to the nuts and bolts of essential oils, it's all about scent. After all, that's what makes essential oils smell good and work on the body and mind. An oil's scent tells us many things about its quality and purity. It also dictates how you blend it with other essential oils in your aromatherapy creations. Your nose is your guide on this aromatherapy journey. Don't fret. By using the guidelines in this chapter, the tasks of choosing oils and blending are not as monumental as they may seem. Soon, you'll be able to differentiate between top-of-the-line essential oils and the run-of-the-mill variety, as well as the downright stinky ones. In this chapter, I tell you how to train your nose to truly understand essential oils. At the same time, you'll be developing your sense of smell so you can judge the quality of essential oils. Knowing what's good and what's not helps you not only when blending oils, but in choosing which ones to buy. This chapter gives you the tricks of the fragrance trade so you can choose the best oils and then make incredible blends with them. Choosing and using oils. Your nose knows best. To better understand an essential oil, let's dissect scent. We're looking at not just what oils smell good or not so good, but what creates all those interesting layers of different scents. You can use that characteristic scent to identify a certain oil and judge its quality. Also, pay attention to the scent when blending an oil with other essential oils to make your final product smell not just great, but fantastic. The following sections walk you through the tried-and-true sniffing procedure used by perfumers and other smelling experts. Whether you're a beginner or already whipping up your own essential oil concoctions, why not improve your ability to judge essential oils and blending skills like a pro? Both of these talents are important when working with essential oil. Tip: while you go through this chapter, don't just read about how to understand scent. Put that nose to work. Grab a bottle of essential oil or an aromatic plant and test the techniques for yourself. See what scent categories you can detect with every sniff you take. You'll be amazed at how clever your nose can be. You'll also be delighted at how quickly your brain learns to detect scent. Sniffing 101. Because you rely on your nose to lead you through the essential oils marketing maze and to become a master blender, you need to teach it the tricks of the trade. First, discover how to smell. So, nose, meet scent. When smelling a finished aromatherapy product, such as shampoo or body oil, you can just sniff away because only a small amount of the essential oil is already mixed into the finished product. However, a bottle of pure essential oil is another story. Undiluted oils are quite strong when sniffed directly from the bottle. They don't represent how a final product will smell because it's almost always diluted, so that's no help to you as a blender. Even worse, they quickly put your sense of smell and brain on overload. That olfactory overdose while holding the bottle directly under your nose can make you lightheaded. So why suffer? To sniff essential oils more comfortably and to have a more accurate sense of how they will smell once diluted, try the following. Smell the scent of the oil from the lid rather than the bottle. When sniffing an undiluted essential oil, hold the lid about 6 to 10 inches from your nose. Move the bottle or lid back and forth through the air to dilute the aromatic molecules. After smelling several essential oils, clear your nose palate so that you can keep on sniffing. For tips on how to clear your nose, check out the following section. Clearing your nose. Your capacity to smell begins to decline after about 6 or 7 good sniffs in succession, especially of the same thing. Along with your ability to smell goes your ability to distinguish an oil's subtle characteristics. An obvious problem when you're trying to determine quality or creating a blend. Keep sniffing, and eventually your nose gives out altogether so that you can't smell a thing. To regain your sense of smell, simply take a break and stop smelling the oils for 10 minutes or until your sense of smell returns. If you don't want to wait that long, here are simple techniques that the pros use. Granted, they might seem silly, but trust me, they work. You can recover your sense of smell in less than a minute by walking outside and deeply breathing fresh air. Here's a good way to clear your nose of all those scent molecules bouncing around in there. Think of this as an air wash. Sniffing coffee beans or hovering over a cup of coffee. Yes, you read this correctly. I did say coffee, and you thought it was just for a pick-me-up? Exactly how coffee works on your ability to perceive scent is a bit of a mystery, but it does the trick. Taking several breaths through a wool scarf or cap. There's something about the smell of wool that changes your smell perception. This trick also works well to filter out the scents that linger in a room when you work with essential oils. Not any cap or scarf will do. Make sure that it's a wool one. Putting a few grains of salt on the tip of your tongue. This is not only a good way to regain your sense of smell, but it also illustrates the close connection between sense of smell and your taste buds. The salt cuts short the smell information reaching your brain and sets an empty stage that is ready for a new scent experience. Strengthening your nose. What to do when you feel like you can't smell? I'm often asked, I have a poor sense of smell, but still would like to work with essential oils. What can I do? If this is you, try taking a B vitamin supplement. If that works, get more of this vitamin in your diet. You can develop a keener nose by exercising it through regular practice sessions. Have smell sessions in which you sniff the same essential oil several times a day for a week. Choose something familiar, so even if you can't detect the scent very well, you can imagine it. The only other thing to do is to be patient, especially if your lack of smell is the result of a disease, such as COVID-19, and wait for time to take its course. How important is your sense of smell? It can affect your life. It influences your sense of taste so much that food only has texture. It also is involved with sexual attraction. Your sense of smell is also a warning system that alerts you to avoid foul smells and rancid food that aren't good for you. While this response becomes so automatic that you may barely notice it, you'll miss it when it's gone. Even though a good nose was important to our ancestors for survival, it's not held in high regard these days. One survey asked individuals which of their five senses they would give up first. The overwhelming response was their sense of smell. I doubt they considered that their sense of taste and a few other things would go with it. Talking scents, language of fragrance. Although it may seem complex at first sniff, being able to describe different scents is a useful skill for anyone using essential oils, from beginner to professional. I use it all the time when working with all aspects of essential oils. Aroma language is the terminology that aromatherapists and perfume experts use to describe the components of a smell. It helps you compare one fragrance to another. It helps you clarify what you like in a particular essential oil or in a blend of oils, as well as what you don't like. That's important if you're trying to develop a discriminating nose. It helps you pick out quality products and essential oils or do expert blending. It also helps you figure out when oils get too old to use. Perfumers are often called noses. In the essential oil world, that's a compliment. It means they're good at their trade sniffing out individual compounds in each oil and blending them together. That's also your goal when practicing in aromatherapy. Borrow some tricks of the experts, and soon what you create will not only work therapeutically, but it'll smell fantastic. Perfumers and aromatherapists place essential oils into many categories. These categories give you guidelines for different types of scents to make your blending job easier. For your aromatherapy work, essential oil scents go into three major categories. Scent type. This uses a nature scent to describe what the essential oil smells like. You might say they smell spicy or floral. Scent quality. Quality is a description of the essential oil's intensity and richness. Quality discusses whether it smells like a well-rounded bouquet or flat. The scent may also have other characteristics, such as sharp. Scent notes. This describes the high, middle, or low notes that perfumers discuss. It discusses whether a scent is light and airy and is described as a high note, or whether the scent carries more of a heaviness to make it a middle or a deep/low note. Using the three categories, you can judge quality and make good blends. To do so, develop your aroma language. For example, an essential oil may smell to you like a sharp wood, yet heavy with a low note. Another may seem like a strong, sour citrus, but with a hint of a high note. It may be a foreign language now, but after you begin using phrases like these, they come to you automatically with any fragrance. Of course, unless you encounter someone else who works with essential oils, you may be talking to only yourself. It doesn't matter. Mumble away. The point is that by putting a name on it, you better identify what you're smelling. Remember, a good essential oil blender uses these concepts as guidelines, but not rules. Grasp onto them if you're a beginner, but feel free to be experimental as you begin to master the art of smelling. Sometimes, creativity is born out of breaking the rules. Scent type. Identifying the type of scent is the easiest and most familiar way to categorize scents. In fact, you probably already know these scent categories because they are part of everyday life. When aroma geeks talk about different types of scent, they group together scents according to how they smell. This puts them into categories. For example, think of a floral scent. It smells like, well, flowers. Another category that's sure to make you hungry is spice. Think of the aroma of cinnamon buns or pumpkin pie. You'll know mint from the last time you popped a breath mint or enjoyed peppermint tea. You get the idea. Table 2-1 introduces and explains the basic types of scent produced by nature. This is the typical list of types used by a majority of perfumers and aromatherapists. Feel free to also add your own descriptions, such as fresh or funky. The point is to use whatever you feel best describes a scent. I give you examples of common spices and herbs that fit in each category. Scent. Floral. Description. Think of the fragrance exuded by a bouquet of flowers. Oil example. Rose. Lavender. Scent. Wood. Description. This is the smell of freshly cut wood. Oil example. Cedar, cypress, firs, sandalwood. Scent. Citrus. Description. Imagine the fresh scent of an orange, lemon, or lime. Oil example. Grapefruit, lemon, orange, petitgrain, tangerine. Scent. Herbal. Description. Think of something yummy to eat that contains herbs, like the smell of a pizza, freshly toasted herb bread, or stuffing cooking at Thanksgiving. Oil example. Marjoram, rosemary, sage. Scent. Spicy. Description. Go to the kitchen for a spicy scent. You can find it in cinnamon-flavored oatmeal or hot cinnamon rolls. Oil example. Cinnamon. Cloves. Scent. Minty. Description. Mint smells of chewing gum and mint breath sweeteners. Oil example. Peppermint. Spearmint. Scent. Camphorous. Description. Imagine the pungent, sharp smell of camphor. Think of the smell of mothballs, although the aromatic wood of the camphor tree itself smells sweeter and much more pleasant. A camphorous smell seems to go directly to the top of your head when you sniff it. Oil example. Camphor. Pine. Any of these six types of scents can be interesting in small amounts in an essential oil blend, but potentially overbearing if it dominates. Take camphor. A camphorous scent can be attractive, as it is in geranium, pine, and rosemary. It's when you sniff it in full force that it becomes unpleasant. Give someone pine oil that smells strongly of camphor to sniff, and the first reaction is to wrinkle their nose and pull their head back. When you see a reaction like that, you know that essential oil is too strong. If you sniff an essential oil and it seems to literally float back and forth between more than one scent type, don't worry. Your nose is doing a great job detecting the complex makeup of an essential oil. That's because most essential oils are not one thing, say a basil or peppermint oil, but a cocktail of different compounds. Each compound contributes its own scent and actions. That actually makes many individual essential oils smell like blends all by themselves. And that's a good thing because the process of blending has already begun before you do anything. For example, if you detect a floral scent, a citrus fragrance may be lingering beneath it. It may take a discerning and educated nose to detect all that's going on, but the more you can smell, the better you'll be at judging quality and blending. Another example is pine. The scent is decidedly camphor, but can you also detect the woodsy scent? Although lavender is floral, see whether you can pick up the herbal aroma that is mixed in with it. These and many more essential oils fall under more than one category. Scent quality. Describing a scent's quality is a little more difficult than identifying its type, but not too hard after you get the hang of it. Good essential oils and essential oil blends are described as full-bodied. This means that the scent carries more intensity and a richer, more rounded bouquet of fragrance because it contains more aromatic compounds. On the other hand, you can describe a lower quality oil as smelling flat, one-sided, or just plain weak. You could even call it boring. Tip: trying to define a term like rounded or flat when you're talking scent isn't exactly easy, but compare it to taste. Imagine biting into a cheese sandwich that is made with a slice of cheese between two pieces of plain bread without butter, mayonnaise, or anything. Your taste buds probably don't get very excited about that lunch. Now, envision eating the tastiest sandwich that you can, that has all your favorites. Perhaps it includes pickles, mustard, and tomatoes. Now, that's a fuller taste experience. If this scent describing sounds like wine tasting, that's because it is so similar. The only difference is that you're smelling rather than tasting. Citrus smells a little sour, but the best oils also have a sweet smell. Contrast the sharp smell of tea tree or eucalyptus compared to more mellow chamomile. Following are a list of qualities to detect in essential oils. These aren't official terms used in aromatherapy, but they are ones that will aid your descriptions on essential oils. As with the other categories, make up your own terms if you like. Think about each descriptive pair when smelling an oil. In other words, try to categorize an oil as mellow or sharp, and then move on to detecting whether it's smooth or harsh. You won't necessarily find all these qualities in each oil, but many are obvious. Soft or strong, sandalwood versus clary sage. Mellow or sharp, chamomile versus eucalyptus. Smooth or harsh, vanilla versus citronella. Sweet or bitter, jasmine versus angelica. Sour and acidic or sweet, lemon versus jasmine. Full or flat, rose versus orange. Tip: a trick to familiarize your nose with scent is to choose some common smell, orange or peppermint, for example, and then see whether you can imagine it. It helps to close your eyes and focus on your sense of smell. If this task is too difficult, give your nose a reminder by sniffing an actual orange or a peppermint tea bag, and then put it down and let your imagination try again. Then see whether you can identify the quality. Is it well-rounded or flat? If you have an essential oil that you purchased a long time ago and a newer one, compare the two. Chances are that the older bottle will smell flat because it has lost some of its aromatic punch, and the newer one will smell more full-bodied. Scent notes. A third category classifies fragrance as a high, middle, or low note. Scent is so analogous to music that perfumers borrowed the idea of fragrance notes from musicians. They place different scents on a scale, similar to a musical score, and designate them as top, middle, or bass notes. A fragrance can just have one note, but more notes in the scent create a richer experience. You can try to determine the top, middle, and bass notes for extra credit. It's not easy to pigeonhole an essential oil, especially a complex one, into any scent categories, but perfumers and aromatherapists do it anyway to help them better understand fragrance and blending. If you have a keen nose, you'll pick out many of the oils that have elements of more than one note. A top, high note smells light and is described as airy. A high note is the flirty aspects of smell. It's the first one to greet your nose, but then dissipates quickly. Examples are lemon, grapefruit, lime, and peppermint. A middle note is trickier to detect because it falls somewhere in between the high and low notes. A middle note can confuse your nose by seeming to bounce between the high and low note or take on different notes depending upon what other essential oils are mixed with it. Examples are chamomile, fennel, and marjoram. A bass, low note is just the opposite of a high note. It smells heavy and has staying power. Examples are cedarwood, jasmine, and sandalwood. Tip: imagine that you're listening to music. Someone is hitting the same piano key over and over. You have no interest in continuing to listen. In fact, you wish they would stop. It's very one-sided. Compare this to hearing a full piano concerto played. Many notes are involved, and it moves all around the scale. There is a much richer sound with a full bouquet of notes that sound musical to your ear. Although lavender is floral, it also smells herbal. Then another note comes carrying just a hint of pine. You can see why lavender and many more essential oils are listed under more than one category. Blending it all together. When you understand the language of fragrance, practice identifying individual scents and naming their characteristics. Use the vocabulary in this chapter or make up your own if that's easier. Once your nose is sharp and you've got the fragrance language down, you'll be able to use this information to craft your own concoctions by blending different essential oils that smell good together. Practice, 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 and your nose will be as keen as a professional perfumer's nose. All your experimentation will automatically settle into the part of your brain responsible for remembering scent. So, practice the language, sniffing, and blending. Taking baby steps. Remember, when experimenting to see how different essential oils blend, add each oil in small amounts. That's drop by drop. Keep different batches so you can come back and compare. To aid your comparison, be sure to label everything with the exact amounts you used. When you're learning to create essential oil blends, try starting with a complex essential oil like geranium. Geranium is such a complex oil that it already smells like a blend. This makes it a good starter oil. With all those scents in one oil, whatever you add to it will carry it in a different direction. For example, add rose or another floral, and your blend is decidedly floral. Add any citrus to rose geranium, and your blend moves into that category. In other words, the added scent pulls out the same scent that already naturally occurs in geranium. You can do the same blending trick with other complex oils, such as rose. Training your nose. Did you know that perfumers go to school to learn their trade? While there, they put their noses through drills. You can try some of these at home. They'll help you better get to know the aromas of a variety of essential oils and how they merge when blended. You need to mix only a few drops of essential oil to complete the drills. This exercise comes in handy. It helps you imagine how your blend will smell before you even start mixing oils. Here are a couple of nose drills in which you compare and contrast aromas. Similar study. Mix very similar essential oils together one by one and see how the aroma of the overall blend gradually changes. For example, do a series with citrus. Start with a drop of orange, which is a relatively simple, uncomplex oil. Add another drop of a citrus like lemon. The next drop could be lime or grapefruit. You'll notice the blend becomes more interesting with each drop. Next, try mixing several woods or florals. Contrasting study. In this exercise, choose oils that contrast with each other. Select oils from different categories so the blends will smell quite different. That gives you many, many choices. You can mix a drop of a floral essential oil with a woody one, or a spicy scent with one of the many citrus essential oils. Sweet scent of success. No doubt about it, fragrance sells. Savvy companies are smelling the sweet scent of success as they jump on the aromatherapy bandwagon. Businesses are looking for noses, people who can use fragrance language to create aromatic blends for them. Marketing surveys show that consumers prefer scented products over unscented ones, and the better these products smell, the more they like them. The result? Enticing scents waft from the bakery, thanks to strategically placed fans. Cosmetic companies promise to change your mood if you wash your hair with their aromatherapy shampoo. Many stores pump scent through their heating and air conditioning systems to encourage customers to buy. And they do. When Dr. Alan R. Hirsch, director of the Smell and Taste Treatment and Research Foundation in Chicago, circulated pleasant scents through the air conditioning system of a Las Vegas casino, slot machine sales soared an impressive 40%. He also found that just pitching a sale to someone in a scented room made them more likely to buy. Chapter 3. On the Scented Trail. Shopping. In this chapter, finding the best deals on quality oils, following the essential oil supply chain, recognizing the phonies and identifying the good stuff, being eco-friendly. Essential oils are big right now. All types of stores, including mail-order catalogs and websites, sell essential oils. The problem is, with such a variety of essential oils and aromatherapy products, how do you decide which ones are actually essential? You may need to use an aromatherapy anti-stress formula just to get through all the decisions you'll encounter shopping for essential oils. And when you've made your investment in essential oils and aromatherapy products, and they're not cheap, then you'll want to know how to keep them good for as long as possible. The oils in those little vials have been on quite the adventure before you bring them home, and where they've been might impact your purchase decisions and help you sift through all the marketing. In this chapter, I show you how to tackle the aromatherapy shopping maze and exactly how to store and keep your precious oils to get the most value and effectiveness from them. Finally, I explain the journey from aromatic plant to that essential oil vial in your hand so you know where it came from and can decide whether it's right for you. Searching for good scents. Simply put, the kind of oil you're looking for is a quality, completely natural, undiluted essential oil with full potency. To get that, you need to choose oils that come from an aromatic plant that was properly grown and had its essential oil carefully extracted. You also want your oil to be properly stored and shipped. On your essential oil quest, you need a few tools. You'll want a well-trained nose, a good sense of what to look for in a quality oil, and the ability to choose reliable suppliers. The good news is that you can carry all of these tools with you. For help training your nose, check out Chapter 2. Remember, there's nothing more educational than hands-on, or should I say nose-on, experience. Become familiar with essential oils firsthand and compare the good from the bad. Smell so many essential oils that their scents become etched in your brain. You'll be surprised how quickly that happens. Your sense of smell is connected to your brain's memory areas, so put it to work. You can sniff the movement of essential oils as they move up an aromatic plant as it matures. Pick an aromatic leaf from your yard or a park. Rub it between your fingers and smell. Visit this plant several times during its growing season and notice how the fragrance increases in its leaves until the plant flowers and then slowly declines. Tip: it's a good idea to get to know your essential oils by their aromas before you invest in them. Attend an essential oil workshop presented by an aromatherapist. Find a store with good samples to sniff, or visit a friend who has a substantial essential oil collection. Better yet, do all three. Noticing quality. For quality control, teach your nose to know the difference between essential oils that smell full-bodied and complete rather than flat. Use it to sniff out the individual compounds that give the oils their aroma and healing properties. To do this, pick out the aromatic types and notes that it contains. It's helpful to talk this aroma lingo when you're trying to identify what you're smelling. Yes, even if you're just talking to yourself. Tip: want to learn how to determine essential oil quality and train your nose, and to pick up aroma lingo along the way? It is all covered in Chapter 2. Making the grade. In talking about essential oil grades, the question is whether you always need the best grade and top-of-the-line oils. Is using the highest quality oils practical or even necessary? The answer depends on how you intend to use them. For example, aromatherapy candles and soap require so much essential oil that you can probably turn to a good but inexpensive essential oil. The quality of oil you put in your facial cream is a different story. Don't dump out all the essential oils you've already purchased in fear that you didn't choose the best ones. Don't feel that you always need to spend a fortune. Asking the quality questions. To decide what grade of aromatherapy products and essential oils to use, ask yourself these questions. How am I using the essential oil or finished product? How important is the quality to achieve maximum results? How substantial is the price difference among various qualities? Does the more expensive brand really smell that much better? Do I need to use more of the essential oil to get the desired scent and benefits? Remember, using cheaper essential oils doesn't always save money. An aromatherapist I know manufactured a beautiful body cream. One time, she resorted to scenting it with a low-grade essential oil. The oil didn't provide enough fragrance, so she added more and more oil. It took 4 times the amount of her normal recipe to achieve the right scent. In the long run, it cost her more money, and the cream ended up with far too much essential oil for safety. Choosing among varieties. Essential oils produce many variations. Different versions of the same essential oil smell different and have slightly different uses. But just because the tea tree oil, named MQV, is an especially strong antiviral, that doesn't mean common tea tree won't work great to treat infections, acne, or eczema. In a study, aromatherapist Jane Buckle, RN, used 2 different lavender essential oils with patients recovering from heart operations to help them relax during recovery. Lavandin, a hybrid often considered a lesser grade, proved more effective than true lavender. Also consider your personal preferences. Aromatherapist Mindy Green, co-author of Aromatherapy, The Complete Guide to the Healing Art, and I sat down to a selection of rose essential oils from several different species. As we carefully sniffed and compared, we eventually found our favorites. They weren't the same. It wasn't that one was better quality. We each just had a different preference. Buying essential oils. Make your shopping days easier by following these simple tips. Choose your source wisely. Buy essential oils from companies that have a reputation for quality you can trust. This is not always easy, but look for companies that offer accurate information. It's a good sign if the company is owned by an aromatherapist, or at least has one on staff. Hold back. Don't buy much with your first order from a new company so that you can sample the oils and check out their quality. Ask about the oils. Are they undiluted? Ask where they originated. Have the company supply the botanical names and ensure that their essential oils came from those plants. Check for authenticity. Make sure that the line of essential oils doesn't include any blatantly synthetic essential oils, such as carnation, lilac, or strawberry. If so, all their oils may be synthetics, even if they claim otherwise. Check for purity. See whether the oil stains, has alcohol overtones, or smells weak or not balanced. Check for quality. Sniff out scents that are fuller, rounder, and more complex. A little essential oil should go a long way. Sniffing out the best deals. You may think that the higher the price, the better the essential oil, or that the grade of an essential oil is reflected in its price. This is often the case, but not always your best guide to quality. Lots of factors influence essential oil prices. Looking at price indicators. If you wonder why you see such a large range of prices for essential oils, consider some of the factors that go into pricing. Cost of harvesting the aromatic plants. Ease in producing the essential oil. How much oil the plant produces. Market demand for the oil. Overhead of the company selling the oil. The upcoming Keep on Trucking, Following the Supply Chain, goes into these factors in more detail. Adding up the extras. If you run a business, you know it isn't cheap. You need to pay for packaging and brochures and offer information on your website. The same goes for larger companies. Essential oil businesses may offer personalized instruction, a professional aromatherapy formulator, an aromatherapy advisor, as well as customer service representatives. Just keeping a large selection of essential oils on hand gets expensive, You end up paying for these bonuses, but if they enhance your experience as a consumer, they may be worth that higher price tag. Some companies have their own expensive lab to analyze their essential oils. They can let you know if an oil is pure and unadulterated. Sophisticated equipment also dissects the oil's composition to see whether it contains the right percentage of compounds. Small companies may also have this information supplied by their distributors. Remember, essential.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.